Welcome to Wine, Whiskey, and Song, where we explore the connections we make with wine, with whiskey, and with music. Here's Andy Wesley and Tom Roper. Welcome to Wine, Whiskey, and Song. I'm Andy Wesley. This is Tom Roper. And we're going to go on a bit of an adventure together. The idea behind Wine, Whiskey, and Song is to take the special connections that people find with wine and whiskey and music and use them to understand each other in a different sort of way. Now, some of you might be a little intimidated by wine. I know a lot of the people who I meet, I'd spend my life teaching people about wine, but a lot of people are intimidated by wine because we, the wine industry, have not done a particularly good job explaining to people that wine is a beverage to be enjoyed like all other beverages. So as a starting point, I'm going to pour a little of this Kenwright Pinot Noir for Tom and myself. And let's talk a little bit about wine.
Yeah. Looks great.
So, the important thing to realize about wine is that every wine is about four things and four things only. The grape, the climate, the soil, and the human element. Nothing really too complex about that. So what's the big deal? Why do, you know, wine people like myself spend their entire lives examining this beverage in a way that that we don't with other beverages? The reason for that is because those four things never combine themselves in exactly the same way twice. So there's a little bit of magic about wine because each vintage, year to year, is different. This is a 2015 Bryce Vineyard from Kenwright Pinot Noir. This wine will taste very differently in the 2020 vintage. It'll also taste very differently if we taste it 6 months from right now. But to get started, Tom,
yeah.
Cheers.
Cheers, thank you.
Welcome to this adventure. So let's talk a little bit about each of those four elements of wine, as I like to call them, the grape, the soil, the climate, and the human element. Why grapes? Any idea why we use grapes to make wine and not other fruits? Because you can make wine from any fruit.
I'm going to take a guess.
Okay.
Since I don't know as much, just that it's what was plentifully available in certain regions where they decided they wanted to make wine and it
okay. Happened
to easily ferment into.
Yep. So certain parts of the world, particularly Europe, where you know where wine started, grapes grew plentifully. Now, one of the things that people came to find out is a grape actually has a larger concentration of sugar than other fruits do. The ratio of sugar to water in a grape is more pronounced than it is in an apple or a pear or other things. And since we're going to take those grapes and ferment the sugar and ferment it into alcohol, we want as much concentration of sugar as possible. Mm. Okay, the other thing which you mentioned is that not only do grapes grow all over the place, but we have different flavor profiles for different varietals, as we call them, that grow in different spots in the world. This is a Pinot Noir. The wine is made completely from the Pinot Noir grape. Most of you are probably familiar with Cabernet Sauvignon, which will taste very different than this grape planted in different places. So that's the grape. We got a couple of reasons why the grape is very important. Let's talk a little bit about the soil. And this is a little counterintuitive for people because we tend to think that we would want to grow something in as fertile a soil as possible. Grapes actually grow well in soils that are not very fertile. Another reason why when you were trying to figure out where to plant crops, grapes ended up getting planted in less fertile soils than corn, as an example, because grapes tend to grow in less fertile soils. There's a couple of minerals that are needed to make good wine grapes. And what we really need from soil to make wine grapes is we need soils that drain well. We actually want the grapevines to dig as deep into the soil as possible because there's flavor in the soil along the way. So if a particular soil doesn't have very good drainage and the water sits very close to the surface, the vines are not going to dig down deep into the soil.
Sure, and they get their water like right there. They
right, have to go they're not going to, you know, and one of the things that, you know, I tell people is that we tend to think that grapes exist to make great wines for us. Grapes actually exist just to survive. Right. And because and to propagate the species. So, you know, a grape grows in a particular soil. There are seeds inside. The grape juice is attractive to birds and things like that. They land on the grapes, eat the grapes, transport the seeds other places, deposit the seeds the way that they do. And it ensures that the species can propagate.
Mm-hmm.
So, we want soils that drain well, so the vines have to dig deep into the soil to get to water. And as long as we have that, and a few key minerals that we'll talk about in a session later on, the soil will provide a particular flavor profile and lay a foundation for the vines to create good quality wine grapes.
Mm-hmm.
Climate. What do we need in terms of climate? I tend to think of climate as capturing the mood, you know, giving the grape a particular personality. And we want climates. A grape needs a certain amount of warm days to ripen over the course of an entire growing cycle. And then wine grapes tend to like a large diurnal range in temperature. Diurnal range is the difference between the temperature in the morning and the temperature in the afternoon.
Okay.
Grapes tend to like cool, warm, cool growing cycles. Cool in the morning, warm in the afternoon, cool in the evening. Cool in the springtime, warm in the summertime, cool in the fall. And that's how grapes are going to be able to create the sugars and also the flavors that are needed in order for us to be able to make good wine. Also important to, go ahead.
Is this the thing that, like, as you mentioned earlier, the 2015 is going to taste very different from the 2020? And is that, I would assume a part of that is due to the climate over the course of the year that the grapes were grown.
So, absolutely.
A lot of rain in the spring, or maybe it was too warm in the spring and cool in the summer, and it might just not develop the same as the opposite.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And one of the things that it's important for everyone to understand is that there's a difference between climate and weather. Climate is the average of weather over time. So we make a decision about where we're going to plant vineyards based on climate, based on what's supposed to happen. Mm-hmm. Weather is what happens today, which could be good or bad. And that's why vintage to vintage, there will be changes, as you mentioned, with when it rained, when we got the level of sun that we needed. And one of the important decisions that winemakers and vineyard managers are always looking at is how long can we allow the grapes to stay on the vines before it rains in the fall? Because if it rains late in the season, remember, a grape's only goal is to survive. So anytime there's water in the soil, the vine's going to grab as much of it as it possibly can.
Mm-hmm.
And in doing so, it pulls water into the vine, which ends up in those grapes. And we end up with big, plump grapes like you get, you know, at the grocery store to eat on a Saturday afternoon, mm-hmm. as opposed to small, compact wine grapes that have the ratio of sugar to water and the ratio of skins that we need. And we'll talk about skins more later when we talk about red wine.
So that's it. So there's a lot of rain late in the season. It's going to make that grape just it's too much water to the amount of sugar in the grape.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then the fermentation isn't really going to have something to grab onto.
Absolutely.
The alcohol.
So that's one of the really important things that a winemaker and a vineyard manager are always arguing over, right? The vineyard manager wants to get the crop in. The winemaker wants to allow the grapes to stay on the vine as long as possible so that we can absorb all the interesting flavors and interesting aromas that are going to make that wine interesting to drink later on. So there's always a bit of a debate there. And as we get later into the growing season, a lot of trepidation and concern about how long can we allow these grapes to stay on the vine before it gets cold and it gets rainy. Because if we get cold and rain at the same time, we can end up with mold problems, which you obviously don't want.
Yeah.
So we got the grape, the soil, the climate, and finally the human element. What do humans bring to winemaking? Humans bring an endless number of decisions. Everything from what grape varietal to plant in a particular soil, what side of the hill do we want to plant on, how much am I going to prune my vines back in the springtime? How much am I going to allow those grapes to progress before I make an evaluation of, do I need to drop any fruit? Do I need to take a certain amount of my crop and cut it off the vine and leave it so that the rest of the grapes have more balance and more opportunity to grow correctly? Then we get into once the grapes get to the winery, are we going to ferment quickly or slowly? We tend to want slower fermentations in winemaking so that we can extract as much flavor as we possibly can. Maybe the single most important development in the quality of wine all over the world going up significantly in the past 50 years is the use of stainless steel fermentation tanks. Stainless steel is clean, so we don't have problems with fermentations getting stuck or problems like that. But also, just the fact that we can take a stainless steel tank and drop the temperature and slow down fermentation. Fermentation is yeast eating sugar to form alcohol. One of the byproducts of fermentation is heat. Literally, a fermentation is very hot. Mm-hmm. And therefore, if we don't do anything to control the temperature of the fermentation, we'll get flavor and we'll get alcohol, but we won't extract as much flavor as we can along the way. And we'll talk about all of these things in a lot more detail as we progress through these sessions. We'll also do the same thing in our next session. We'll talk about the four elements that are involved in the making of whiskey. So now let's talk about, if those four elements never combine themselves in the same way, for a long time, I've compared and found ways to use music to explain wine to people. Why? Because music doesn't intimidate everybody. Everybody's got a favorite song. Everybody's got a favorite genre of music. Mm-hmm. But a song is also about four things. A song's about rhythm. A song's about chord progression. A song's about melody. And a song is about lyrics. And those four things also never combine themselves in the same way twice. And because of that, Tom, I know this has happened to you because we've talked about it, and I'm sure it's happened to many of you as well. You can be driving down the highway, listening to a song on the radio, and you're taken back to a particular moment in time.
Absolutely.
Literally remember what you were wearing, maybe what she was wearing, you know, what the mood was, and you feel all those things and feel all those emotions that you did at the time. Mm-hmm. And wine does the same thing because there's an endless combination of the grape, the soil, the climate, and the human element. What we're tasting in this glass is a moment in time that can, you know, the way that a song can bring you back and help you feel all of those things again. And that idea has always fascinated me, and that's the reason why we've decided to create Wine, Whiskey, and Song, which is an opportunity to talk about wine and talk about music. In some of our later episodes, we will teach you how to taste wine the way you listen to music, because there are a lot of interesting factors that we think of very scientifically with wine, like acidity. Acidity is like treble in a song. body is, you know, the body in a wine is like bass in a song. And we'll talk about how we can use all of those things to create interesting connections with people. So hopefully that's interesting to all of you, and you'll want to come along on this journey with us. We are going to, along the way, play some songs for all of you. The first song that we're going to play is a song that was originally recorded by a gentleman named John Cougar, who then changed his name to John Cougar Mellencamp, and then decided to actually use his real name, which he uses now, John Mellencamp. And the reason that we decided to start with this song, I once heard John Mellencamp interviewed about what this song is actually about. And he said at the time that Jack and Diane was a song about finding significance in insignificant things. And we thought that that was a great place to start this adventure together. So we're going to pick up our guitars here and play Jack and Diane for you.
That is a nice wine. Something interesting just about the subject of, like, finding, like, it's like something I was thinking about when you were talking about wine, significance and insignificance. Like, you might just open up a bottle of whatever wine and just drink it with your meal, and it's just part of the meal, and you're really not mindfully thinking about it. Just like you might listen to a song in the background while you're working or driving. But if you're really tasting a wine mindfully, or listening to a song, something like, I haven't really sat down and lately just really sat down and just to listen. This might be something interesting to talk about at some point. Really listening to a song or an album. Like paying attention, as opposed to, it's not just in the background while I'm driving.
Well, and having said that, you know, the way that you mentioned just drinking a wine while you're having a meal, the wine is changing the meal in ways that you don't even understand and you don't even think about, right? Just like, you know, the song that's playing in the background in the car when you're having a conversation with someone is changing that conversation. Think about all of the movie scenes that were changed by the song that was playing as you were listening to them.
You
became more afraid of the shark because of that dump, 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 dump in Jaws.
You didn't have to see the shark.
Right.
It was great. They didn't have to show that shark very much. Which the, you know, effects in 1974, 75 weren't what they are today.
Yeah.
Like, you could not see the alien, not see the shark, but the music really evoked that fear.
Sure.
Yeah.
And wine does the same thing, right? Mm-hmm. It's just the thing that's playing in the background during a meal. Now, for me, a lot of times I can't tell you what I ate for dinner when my wife and I went to Alinea on our anniversary 15 years ago. But I can tell you every wine we drank. Because the wine crystallizes the moment for me.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's one of the things that's always sort of fascinated me about wine and music. You know, they both crystallize emotions in a way that other beverages don't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's absolutely, absolutely. Whiskey is kind of similar.
Yeah, and we'll talk about whiskey next time.
Jack and Diane, two American kids growing up in the heartland. Jack gonna be a football star. Diane debutante backseat of Jackie's car. Sucking on chili dogs, outside the taste of freeze. Diane's sitting on Jackie's lap, got his hands between her knees. Jackie said, hey, Diane, let's run off behind the shade tree. Dribble off those Bobby Brooks slacks and do what I please. Saying, oh, yeah, life goes on. Long after the thrill of living is gone. Oh, yeah, they say life goes on. Long after the thrill of living is gone, they walk on. Jack sits back, clicks his thoughts for the moment, touches his head and does his best James Dean. Well, man, damn, Diane, we ought to run through the city. Diane said, baby, you ain't missing nothing. Jackie said, oh, yeah, life goes on. Long after the thrill of living is gone. Oh, yeah, they say life goes on. Come on, the thrill of living is gone. So let it rock, let it roll. Let the Bible Belt come and save my soul. Hold on to 16 as long as you can. Changes come around real soon, make us women and men. Oh yeah, life goes on. Long after the thrill of living is gone. Oh yeah, they say life goes on. Long after the thrill of living is gone. Little ditty by Jack and Diane. Two American kids doing best they can.
Thanks for joining us. We'll be back soon with another episode of Wine, Whiskey, and Song. In the meantime, please like the video and leave any comments you have. And of course, subscribe to our channel.